At first, Israel's Minister of Economy and the leader of the hawkish Jewish Home Party, Naftali Bennett. He's here in the United States to lobby congressional and public opinion against any easing of sanctions on Iran right now. Mr. Bennett, welcome to the program and thank you for joining me.
It's great to be here, Christiane.
Now, you are being described, or I'm going to describe you, as Mr. No. You do not want a deal that's under proposal right now to be struck, nor do you want the United States or Europe or the UN to lift or ease any sanctions. Do you think you're actually going to succeed in this lobbying effort?
It's quite the contrary. We actually want a deal. We just want the right deal. And the right deal is a deal that dismantles the nuclear weapon production machine. Let me explain. Iran has a pipeline that produces uranium. They have 18,000 centrifuges that every 6 weeks can produce enough uranium for one nuclear bomb. Their plan is not to break out today with a bomb. They don't want a bomb now because the whole world's looking at them and they don't need those economic sanctions. Their actual plan is to retain the machine, ease the sanctions, and wait perhaps 6 months, 12 months, 18 months until the world's distracted with one thing or another, and then within 6 weeks, break out. So a good deal is a deal, Christine, that dismantles their entire pipe. A bad deal is one that just turns off the faucet temporarily, but leaves that machine in their hands, and then we know for sure that at a later date they'll break out.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that Secretary Kerry is an honest broker, and are you prepared, as it looks like Prime Minister Netanyahu is, I mean, really sort of moving the fight against the Obama administration to a very stressed out degree? I mean, really creating a fight with your strongest ally?
Christiane, America is our strongest ally, and America is a big friend, and so is the Obama administration. Over the past several years, we've strengthened our ties with our security ties, our intelligence ties. However, there is a degree of disagreement. We agree to the objective, which is preventing Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons. There is a degree of where we don't really agree on how you get to that. Now, we feel that Iran right now is on the ropes. They have to be presented with an either-or situation. Either you retain your nuclear program or you have an economy. You can't have it both ways. We feel right now that a third way will allow Iran to wiggle out of those sanctions, ease the sanctions, keep the machine, and wait for an opportune moment. And I want to point out, right now are our fateful days. If 5 years from now or 10 years from now a nuclear suitcase blows up in New York, it'll be traced down to these very fateful days. Because if Iran does acquire a nuclear weapon, so will Saudi Arabia, so will Syria and Libya. The Middle East will become a nuclear nightmare and no one will be able to control this thing. So we have, now is the time to present Iran with an either-or decision.
Now, Mr. Bennett, you know, the United States administration, the Obama administration, and Secretary Kerry have said, look, we want to at least try this track. We think we have a better chance than we've had in the past. And the president is going to be briefing leading members of the Senate, leading Democratic and other leaders tomorrow, and asking for some space to continue these negotiations. I guess my question to you is, what is the option? I mean, I think you probably read the polls as well. You know that the U.S. people are not for military intervention anywhere in the Middle East right now. And as one former Bush administration official said, that the one thing that the congressional leaders love more than Israel is an aversion to any military action right now. So do you really think you're going to be successful in your lobbying effort?
Christiane, there's no one who wants a war less than us. We've got 100,000 Hezbollah Iranian missiles targeted at our cities if a war erupts. So we do not want a war. I've fought, unfortunately, in several wars behind enemy lines. I've lost friends. We do not want war. I know what it means. However, it's one of those cases where a bad deal will lead to a war and a good deal will actually prevent war. Because if we have a bad deal, Iran retains its nuclear machine, then it means that inevitably there will need to be a military action to prevent Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon. And, you know, we're talking
about... Are you saying that Israel is prepared to go it alone, as the former national security advisor said?
Look, Israel in the past, when faced with a rogue nation acquiring a nuclear weapon in 1981, we attacked Iraq, the Osirak nuclear core, and we destroyed it. Without doing that, Saddam Hussein would have become a nuclear power. And in 2007, Israel allegedly attacked Bashar al-Assad's nuclear core. And had we not done that, allegedly, Bashar al-Assad would today have a nuclear weapon. Imagine this guy who's butchered 110,000 of his own citizens holding a nuclear bomb. So Israel has the ability to defend itself, and Israel will defend itself if necessary. But the best outcome is to prevent this whole thing from happening by standing strong. You know, Iran's on the ropes. The referee's counting 6, 7, 8, 9. And we're very near the point where Iran will have to give up its nuclear program. And at this very moment is the last thing you need to do is pick up the other guy and tell him, you know what, we'll ease the sanctions.
Mr. Bennett, I don't think the United States nor the P5 plus one believe that Iran's going to abandon its nuclear program. However, I do want to ask you about the other issue that you've just brought up, and that is potential peace, a deal between Israel and the Palestinians. Here in New York, you have said that you are vehemently against a Palestinian state, and previously you've said that you don't believe there ever will be one. Do you really believe that? I mean, you're part of a government that is committed to negotiating such a thing.
Well, I think that what we need to do with the Palestinians, and because we are neighbors, is build it bottom up. We need to invest in the economy. We need to invest in more joint businesses. The situation on ground is very positive. I think trying to enforce artificial state in the heart of Israel, in Jerusalem, is a grave mistake. And just consider one point. Right now, Abu Mazen only represents about 40% of the Palestinians. There's a whole nother terror state in Gaza belonging to the Hamas. Let's assume what won't happen, that we sign a deal with Abu Mazen. Do the 1.5 million Arabs in Gaza also have to comply? Who says? They say that no deal would be enforced on them. So I feel that we're sort of spending too much effort on the diplomatic arena, which is not very promising, and we should focus on bottom-up peace. And that's what I do as Minister of Economy.
You have lashed out against the Israeli negotiator Zippy Livni, and again, you have said that you don't ever think a peace deal will happen. But I wonder whether you think it was wise of your colleague, the housing minister, to announce this massive new building in the occupied West Bank. Even the prime minister didn't know about it and was pretty angry about it.
Well, first of all, Christiane, you talk about occupied. I just want to point out one
thing. No, let me just ask the question.
No,
please.
But since you say the term occupied, I have to point out, I'm holding a coin.
It's an international
from
term.
Jerusalem.
It's an international
in
term,
Hebrew,
Mr. Bennett.
I know, and I don't accept it, because this coin, which says in Hebrew, Freedom of Zion, was used by Jews 2,000 years ago in the state of Israel in what you call occupied. One cannot occupy his own home. Now, to your question, you know, Israel, beyond the Green Line, there's 700,000 Israelis. There's vast cities, and they need to live. And we've always said that we will continue to serve this population. However, the building of communities there is not a hindrance to peace. You know, only 7% of the entire West Bank or Judea and Samaria is built today. 93% is open, so no one's stopping peace. If the Palestinians want peace, they have to do one simple thing. Recognize Israel as the Jewish homeland. That's all. But if they don't do that, if they don't recognize Israel as the Jewish homeland, they can't expect peace.
Naftali Bennett, thank you for joining me.
Thank you very much, Christiane.